So what we're going to do is we're going to just bow our heads before the Lord. If you want to stand up, you're free to do that. Dear Father God, we just surrender our hearts to you right now. God, we ask in the name of Jesus that whatever the word is that you have for us today, that God, we would not leave the same, that it would just drop so deep into our hearts, God, that you would launch us into what it is you need us to do. And Lord, we pray, Holy Spirit, that you'd fill us, that you'd equip us, that you'd show us how to be better Christians and stronger Christians for you, Lord, that we would preach your name to the ends of the earth. And Lord, we pray for every church that is preaching the gospel today. Lord, we ask that you would go before them, that you bless them, that you'd anoint them. Lord, we ask that you'd fill every sanctuary and our sanctuary, God, and that you would speak your word and that people would be saved and lives would be changed. And everybody said, amen. Amen. Well, it is really a privilege and an honor. I don't take this lightly to be in this pulpit. And I just want you to overcome some objectives. I know I'm a woman, number one, but that's okay because you know what? You guys like women around here, okay? We are a church that totally believes in the girl and totally loves, and I believe your daughters are going to one day preach from these pulpits. And so, you know, God has some good things, but not just that. I know my voice can get a little bit high, okay? So if you're like, oh, she's screechy, just look past the voice and hear the Spirit of God because God is going to say some things past that screechy voice. And sometimes I'm a little bit passionate. Sometimes I just get really into what I'm saying because the Word of God is so incredibly alive inside of me. And you know, instead of going, man, she's crazy, I want you to say, man, I want some of that because I want to be passionate for God. So let's do this. You guys ready? Pens and papers out, notepads out. We've been getting into Hebrews. So I'm going to read Hebrews, and I'm going to read it in the New Living Translation. I am one of those people that I'm not the smartest cookie in the jar. You know, many times I'll read something. I have to read it like 8 times to get it because I'm like, I don't really quite understand what I'm reading at first. And so I went into the New Living Translation, not that I didn't understand it, but I went into the New Living Translation, and I loved how it worded in Hebrews 12. So let's go there. Therefore, since we are surrounded by such a huge crowd of witnesses to the life of faith, let us strip off every weight that slows us down, especially in sin that so easily trips us up. And let us run this race with endurance, the race that God has set before us. We do this by keeping our eyes on Jesus, the champion who initiates and perfects our faith because of our joy awaiting him. He endured the cross, oh, I love that, disregarding shame, and now he is seated at the place of honor beside God's throne. Think of all the hostility he endured from sinful people. Then you won't become weary and give up. After all, you have not yet given your lives in your struggle against sin. We have to run our race because you know what? Our sin has not killed us. You know, Jesus went to the cross and he died for our sins so that we don't have such a struggle in it that our lives are taken. Isn't that a beautiful thing? What a beautiful sacrifice that we have such freedom to deal with our sin, come to the throne room with our sin because God already paid a price. And you know, many times we have been empowered in this message. Pastor Dan talked about keeping our eyes on Jesus and not looking at the former things and the side things, the peripheral things. And during this race, sometimes you can get a little weary. On your race, you're going to have some tragedy. On running your race, you're going to want to give up at times. You're going to want to say, enough, I'm just done. This is always a constant fight, a constant devotion, a constant settling of my heart. And you know what? I want to say to you today, don't give up the race. The race is worth running. The race may not be an easy race to run, and every lap might be a different lap, and every lap may require something new of you. But in this race, you are growing up, and you are becoming mature. You are reaching new capacities. You are reaching into new places, and God has some incredible things for you. So today, I have called this running our race and finishing strong, because we are more than conquerors, and we've got this, because our Jesus did it first, and we can follow him. God doesn't leave us with just that. You know, he tells us to run our race, but all of us are a part of a family. Look around. I want you guys to look around at each other. And online, look at me. Okay, and this is what we're going to do. These are your brothers and sisters. Did you know that? You all look very different. I'm looking in our congregation. I love our congregation. Multicultural, we're young, we're old, multigender. I think it's a beautiful picture of Jesus. It's a beautiful picture of what heaven is going to look like. And so the girlfriend and the boyfriend next to you, guess what? they're your brother and sister, and we're all family. And in a family, each of us have a job to do. In a family, everybody has a position. Now, I'm not talking about what line of position you were born in. Maybe you're a middle child, and maybe you're an older child, or maybe you're the youngest. That's not what I'm talking about. I'm talking about, let me give you an example. In my family, there's five of us. I have three little children and my husband. I have a daughter and two sons. And we moved into this new house and I began working, and I started working so much that the pile of laundry started to get bigger and bigger and bigger. It got to the point where I was throwing it in a room and it just stays in a pile. And if somebody needs a pair of underwear or socks, we are looking in that room for the underwear and socks. And I said to Dan, if anybody knows me, I'm kind of a clean freak. I like things in order. I don't do well when things are out of order. And I was getting a little frazzled. And I said, Dan says to me, well, why don't you put these kids to work? I mean, come on, what are we doing everything for? And all of a sudden, I was like, ding, yeah, I have children that could be my slaves. My mom used me that way. I could do it too. And so all of a sudden, we started distributing jobs in our house. And our little six-year-old, he empties the dishwasher. My middle child, he gets up on the counter and puts all the dishes away for him because he can't reach them. You know, Titus likes puzzles, so I have him put all the socks together. They never quite end up the same socks. So if you see my children with mismatched socks, hallelujah, they're clean. And everybody in our family has a spot and a job. It's the same in the house of God. Each of us have a spot, and each of us have a job, and each of us need to take on the mission of Jesus Christ. And so we are on this mission. We're running this race together. Together, we are better than we are apart. And so let's be a family. The Word of God gives us our mission, and that might look different for each of us. In Mark 16:15, it says, and then he told them, go into all the world and preach the gospel and the good news to everyone. That's your job. That's your mission. That's what it is. You say, well, that just seems so nerve-wracking. I don't like talking to people. I don't like getting outside of my box. I'm really okay with me and God's relationship, but then I don't know how to engage in a conversation with someone else. And listen, you are filled with the Holy Spirit, and He will ordain moments for you, and He will prompt your heart, and He will say, go ahead and say something right now. And what do I say? I don't know what to say. Maybe it's just a beautiful smile. Like, hi, how are you today? I went into a store the other day, and I had a shirt that said, a little coffee and a whole lot of Jesus. And I was running errands because I was getting something ready for a wedding that was at my house, and I had forgot I kind of had my grubby shirt on. And I ran out, and I'm at this cashier. I went to a couple stores. I went to the first store, and the cashier at the first store was really nice to me. And I had my purse in front of me, and then I moved my purse to the side to, you know, help her out and to sign some things. And as soon as she read my shirt, her head went down, and she wouldn't look at me for the rest of the transaction. And I thought, what did I do? I forgot what I was wearing, you know? And she was of another religion, and it was an obvious one. And you know what I did? I went down on her level, and I said, thank you so much for helping me today. You were such an encouraging, like, help. I didn't know where to go, and I didn't know what I was doing. And she's like, oh, yeah, okay. And I just walked away. I went to the next store, and then I forgot, honestly, what I was wearing again. And this other lady helped me. And when she read my shirt, she was like, oh my goodness, yes, ma'am, thank you so much. God bless you. All of a sudden, the Christianese came out. And I got two different reactions. And you know what? Something as simple as wearing a shirt that says the name of Jesus keeps us accountable. Something as simple as your bumper sticker on the back of your car. Some of you don't want it on the back of your car because you know you're bad drivers and you still use the middle finger sometimes. That is not being a good witness, okay? We've got to get better at this. So that is what I'm talking about. Just simple things. Go out and preach the gospel. And eventually, if you build a rapport with somebody, you can invite them to church. I had some people at my house yesterday, and while everybody else was at the wedding, they had the taco man. We all love a taco man around here, right? And while they were there, yes, thank you, Jesus, Mexican food. And while they were there, they were hanging out, and I noticed they were just standing there by themselves, two young guys. And I never, ever want anything that I do to not say the name of Jesus. So I went up to them, I said, hi, how old are you guys? And they told me, you know, 18 and 16. I said, do you go to church anywhere? well, no. And I go, well, listen, we're the Rock Church. A whole bunch of these people are from the Rock Church, and I want to invite you. And the guy said to me, he goes, wow, thank you. Thanks for being nice. Okay, we'll come check it out. You know, so listen, you're always on. You're never not on. You're a full-time minister of the gospel of Jesus Christ. And just because I'm a pastor does not mean that I'm the only one to do this, guys. I need the Rock Church to get on board and to go out and preach the gospel. Could we do that together? Well, let's learn how to run this race. How do we then keep running this race and preach the gospel? Number one, we have to realize some things about ourselves because we're the first to disqualify ourselves from the race. You are your own worst enemy. And so we have to get past ourselves in order to keep on running. And God showed this to me. He said, number one, they need to learn to flourish as you were created to do. You say, wow, I don't feel like I'm flourishing in anything. I'm not good at anything. Like I said, I'm not a good reader. I'm not the smartest cookie in the jar. Many times my poor husband has to explain things to me 50 times. I'm like, oh, I get it. And, you know, honestly, you could disqualify yourself. Insecurity comes in several forms, but all of us deal with it. All of us deal with it on some level. And so when we realize that God created us in his image, in his form, in it, what he wanted us to do, he equipped us to do it as well. You see, when I have a child, I want the best for my child. I want my child to excel in everything, right? I'm going to set my kids up for greatness. I'm going to pour into them so that they pour out goodness, right? Same thing with God and us. And so when we come to know this amazing God, did you know his plans were never for us to be broke down, busted, and disgusted? It was never for us to be sad and depressed. It was never for us to be in a constant struggle or a constant trial. No, God says, I want you to understand that I need you to step into your path of flourishing. I need you to understand that you are taking on me and that you are my daughter and my son and that you are beginning to mirror my reflection. You see, we take on the look of Jesus. We are his hands and we are his feet. He is at the right hand of the Father, but we are his ambassadors and we carry him everywhere we go. And so when we understand that there's a flourishing that needs to happen inside of us, all of a sudden a little confidence can get in there. All of a sudden, okay, I'm a son and a daughter of God. I've got this. You know what? I'm not going to let the lies of the enemy or what people are saying about me to hold me down and keep me down. I'm not going to allow that to not let me push forward and push past the pain and push past the hard times. I'm not going to let it hold me back. I'm not going to let it take me off of my race. I'm not going to let it push me down and I'm not going to get back up. You're going to get back up, son and daughter, because you were called to flourish. And even though we fall down, get back up and flourish. You see, God loves us. God created us. He poured into us. He's in love with us. Did you know that? That he loves you? You may not have had an earthly father that loves you. Oh, but you had a heavenly father that loves you, and he cherishes you, and he adores you, and he leans in and can't wait to be with you, and he wants you to connect with him on a personal level so that he can pour into you so you could pour out and be a blessing to others. When we were at Women Rock Conference, we had our theme, and it was black and white pictures, just black and white pictures. And everywhere the person in the pictures stood was a color being expressed. When she shot her bow and arrow and it hit the tree turned into color. And that's a beautiful picture of who we are in this world. Everywhere you go, in every part, in every place you step into, you carry the Holy Spirit, and color follows you. You are the one that brings life. You are the one that brings Jesus. When you step on the scene, you bring Jesus on the scene. When you step on that baseball field as a parent, you step Jesus onto that baseball field as a parent. When you are at work and you have a hard boss, but you know what? You're showing love anyways, and you're going to be an awesome employee anyways. You are showing the love of Jesus, and you are bringing a reflection of him to where you go. This is what God is asking of us. Everywhere we go will come to life. Everything we touch will be a blessing to the kingdom of God because you are a blessing to him. In John 7, 37 through 8, it says, on the last day, that great day of the feast, this is before Jesus was leaving, he was going to go sit at the right hand of the Father. He was talking to them. And Jesus stood and he cried out saying, if anyone thirst, let him come to me and drink. He who believes in me, As scripture has said, out of his heart will flow rivers of living water. He was referring to the Holy Spirit because he was going to leave and the Holy Spirit was going to come. And when the Holy Spirit comes, guess what? He fills us. He equips us. We carry him everywhere we go. We can have a new boldness and we can have a new confidence and we can overcome those things that we've never been able to overcome before because listen, our race is not in our own ability and in our own power. Our race is with him and through him and because of him. And because of that, we can flourish in our race and rivers of living water can pour out on our families. Rivers of living water can flow out on your jobs. Rivers of living water can flow out on a personal conversation and a conflict that may be uncomfortable and hard to deal with. But when you bring Jesus into the mix, you bring the Jesus and the love of God, and it flourishes like a beautiful tapestry. It flourishes like a beautiful plant planted in a ground that is so strong and so ready to do what it needs to do. You see, you are his hands. You are his feet. Let's keep the God perspective. Number two, I'm moving on. Number two, keep the God perspective on your race. It's going to be so hard. You're running your race and you look to the side. Oh, get distracted. You know, it's like dogs. Oh, shiny. You know, let's not be Christians like that. You know, when you tell a dog squirrel and they go running off to something else, you know, let's not be that way. Let's keep our focus straight on. And Jesus is the author and the finisher of our faith. He is the beginning and the end. He is the reason we run. And so, you know what? Let's get his perspective. Sometimes you're gonna have to make some decisions in life. You guys are surrounded by family and culture and things that have been a certain way in your world for a really long time. And you're going to have to make some godly decisions, not family decisions. You're going to have to make some new ways of doing things because you're now a new creation in Christ and you are part of a kingdom family now. So our perspective is going to have to change. How you see things is going to have to change. Listen, we are coming into an election. And this election has tore the church apart as a whole. And it is not about that. It is about what does God want in this election? What does God want for America? What does God want us as Christians to stand for? What does God care about? What is God focused on? What is important to God's heart? That's what we need to vote for. You see, I got to get the God perspective in every aspect of my life. Because if I begin to do things off of what is normal and how I do life, I'm going to mess up in my marriage. Because maybe you didn't see a good marriage, so you're going to pick up old ways. But get back into the Word of God, which will teach you how to do marriage properly. Maybe you weren't the best parent, and now you want to be a good parent because you just met Jesus. Guess what? He talks about parenting all over the Word of God. And you know, we have to get the God perspective. Let me tell you why. Because there's a generation behind us watching us. There's a generation behind us listening to us and seeing how we carry out the ways of God. And what we make important in our hearts, in our lives, and what we draw the line on, they also will see the importance of it. They also will pick up on the goodness of God. They also will begin to see things through God's eyes. And then when they go to school and they hear something different, you know what happens? I don't think that's right because I know my word and I know what God says and I've seen the goodness of God. That's what we need to get a God perspective. We have to renew our minds. It is not our ways, but his way. It is a dying of ourselves constantly. I know this is odd for our society because it's all about us, right? Like, what's in it for me? Like, how could I get the upper hand in this business transaction? And how can I do it? It's all about me and my gain. But with God, it's all about you dying and his gain. Because it's about souls. So it's completely opposite of how the world operates. It's completely opposite of what you're going to hear in society and in our culture. Your identity is wrapped up in him and his perspective of you, not what the world says that you are or who you should be. Do we understand? Because I can relate with something because maybe I'm more comfortable in that group of people. But how about God is saying, no, just because I built you a certain way doesn't mean you're part of that group. I need to use you for some things. I've got some greater things for you, and I'll teach you how to use them if you tap into me and find out your identity through me, because identity was created by God, because we're supposed to mirror him. And it's sad to me how our culture has so taken it off the perspective of God and onto all things that will let us down. So let's keep our focus on God. There was a young man who was an incredible man. His name was David, and he came up against a big old giant Goliath. And David had such a perspective on God, he was able to be a man that could be victorious over Goliath. Now, Goliath was humongous, and David was just a poor shepherd boy who just loved Jesus and did his job. How about you? I'm just somebody who loves Jesus and just in my spot doing my job. But you know what? When those Goliaths come against me, when those things and those hard times hit, I'm going to need to look back at stories like David, and I'm going to need to say, you know what? I'm getting the God perspective on this because this is too big for me. These are things I don't understand. These are prayers that I don't have the answer to, but God does. So I'm going to tap in and reach into what God wants and his perspective. David in 1 Samuel, verse 17, go there with me. It says, verse 32, do not worry about this Philistine, David said to Saul. Saul is freaking out. He says, I'll go fight him. That's a confidence inside this little guy, right? Verse 33, Saul replied, do not be ridiculous. There is no way that you can fight this Philistine and possibly win. You are only a boy, and he's been a man of war since your youth. Pretty much saying, you have no chance. I'm not going to send you out to the wolves. This is not a good choice, okay? And David goes on. I love this. But David persisted. I have been taking care of my father's sheep and goats, he said. When a lion or a bear comes to steal the lamb from the flock, I go after it with a club and I rescue the lamb from its mouth. The animal turns on me and I catch it by its jaw and I club it to death. I have done this both to lion and to bears. And I'll do it to this pagan Philistine too, for he has defied the armies of the living God. You see, David knew who was backing him. He knew God's perspective on this situation. He knew that he could defeat him, not in his own ability, but with God on his side. He had the God perspective of things. And when the hell and high water came against him, he said, I'm not afraid. I've got this. It's not too big for my God. And you know, David went and Saul tried to give David his armor, which I thought was really quite a picture. And it just hung on him because it didn't fit David because he was so small. So he wasn't the regular size of a man. He was smaller than that. And he took it off and he said, I've got to do this the way I do it. I'm paraphrasing now. Okay. So if you're following it in the Bible, it's not going to be the same. And he took out three smooth stones. And he got them ready. And then he went against Goliath. And Goliath was patronizing him. Listen, the world is going to patronize you. The world is going to poke at you. The world is going to tell you, oh, really? You believe in this God? And what you believe, you're going to take that road with your kids? And oh, what are you doing with this? And how's your marriage? They're going to totally not understand what it is you're living for. They're going to not understand why you're living and running your race the way you are. And you know what? You just keep going, girl. Girlfriend and boyfriend, you just keep running that race. You keep taking a hold of that ground because when the lion and when the bear comes, those are victories you can put in your faith notch. And when Goliath comes, you can get the God perspective and take him down, which is one sling. David hit Goliath right in the center, and that man fell and he cut his head off. And he said some amazing things that God was after him. I love this quote. It says, get the right perspective. When Goliath came against the Israelites, the soldiers all thought, he is so big, we can never kill him. Have you ever felt that way in life? Oh, the situation's so big, I don't know if we're gonna do it. Oh, this, you know, my kids are just so lost. I don't know if I'm ever going to see them serve God. Oh, this marriage, it just feels like it's at the end of its ropes. Oh, these finances, how are we going to pay these bills? How are we going to get ahead of things? Oh, sickness has come on my body, and now I just feel devastated and depressed. Oh, but this is what David says to it. He says, the soldiers thought he's so big, I can't kill him. And David looked at that same situation, and he said, he's so big, I can't miss him. Listen, look at your situation, get the God perspective. God's so big, you can't miss out. God's so big, it won't be defeated. God's so big, you're going to overcome. God's so big, you're his ambassador of the Holy Spirit. Let's get the God perspective on our race. Let's run our race so that it's so pleasing to God that he can use us. Our lives and our culture cannot be louder than what God says. I want to say that again. Our lives and our culture cannot be louder than what God says. Let's change our culture to be who God is. Let's change it to be a loud voice in this dark land. Let's get a God perspective on every single lap that we take in our race so that we can stay on our lap. Last point, remember why we're running. We are running for Jesus. That is why we do what we do. That is why we keep going. That is why we press forward. That is why we equip ourselves and we come to church weekly and we fill ourselves back up so we can keep back on our race. That's why you have friends that you keep accountable, Christian friends, and you meet people in small groups and you meet people when you volunteer. That's why you get into the house of God. You put your hand to the plow. This is why we push you into these things. You say, oh, you just want my help because you need someone to do it. No, because I know it's going to be good for you because you're going to meet new people. You're going to be able to encourage each other. When you feel lonely, you don't have to feel lonely. You have a whole team of people running this race with you, and you need to link up with them, and we need to do this together. Running our race for Jesus. That's why we run. Listen, we run our race for the next generation. There is a generation that is very loud right now, and they are the biggest ones. They're the millennials. And I've heard it said that the millennials, oh, the millennials, you know, they're just lazy and they're selfish and they're into themselves and da-da. Listen, let's stop saying that about them. Let's start helping them with their adult life. And listen, let's listen to them too, because they know how to maneuver. They know how to work in their culture. They know how to work in their generation. And if we're going to reach people for Jesus, we need to listen and we need to do it. That's going to catch the heart of the young people so that they will serve the Lord in the future. You see, it's not about just one generation and not another. It's about all generations working together, linking arms and saying, I've got your back. You know, a lot of people don't have fathers and mothers, younger people. How about some of the older generation says, well, I've got some time. I'd love to mentor. I'd love to teach them how to be a man. I'd love to teach her how to be a lovely lady. I'd love to get the word and maybe have coffee together and we can go over some things in the word. You see, there's opportunity for you to never stop being a full-time minister. And when one is in need, another one has the answer in the body of Christ. Because remember, we all play a role on our mission. We all are a part of this race. And let's be together. Let's run it for the next generation, because they have to carry the gospel into their generation, and we have to equip them to do it. And then listen, running our race for Jesus means we have to love our spouses. Like, oh no, don't talk about that today. We got in a fight on the way here and I don't want to talk about it. Listen, girls, you have to come into submission to your husband. There's such freedom in it, because if he makes a bad decision, guess what? God has to cover him, and it's not your problem. And men, you're to love your wife as Christ loves us, the church. That's big. You better hit the jewelry store up today. I'm kidding. You see what I'm saying? God wants us to run our race beautifully because people are watching a reflection of our marriages. The children, people on the outside are watching how we love each other. They're watching how does a Christian marriage work versus an unchristian marriage. We're running our race and people are watching. We run it for Jesus. And when we do it the right way, it's a reflection of him. Our marriage can be a reflection of him. That's why we run. Being the best employee on the job. Listen, quit trying to cut corners. Quit trying to, like, you know, get the easy way out. Don't be the first to leave at 5 o'clock. Be the last to leave, because you know what? You're just in love with what God's asked you to do. And you don't work that job for the man. You work that job to honor God and to take care of your families. There's honor in that. There's honor in it. And when you're on the job and you have a hard boss, I had 15 jobs before I worked at the church. Did you know that? 15. I had some great bosses, and then I had some not so great bosses. And honestly, the bosses that I had, it taught me a lesson every time. And there was this one job I had, and it was a hard one. It was an uncomfortable one because a boss made it uncomfortable. And what I did was I kept in my heart, you know what, I'm going to do this before God, and I'm going to work hard for the things of God. I'm not doing this for him. I'm not doing this for that. I'm doing this, and I'm going to work according to God. And you know what happened? I got promoted. I just got promoted, and I couldn't believe it. I just could not believe it. I had this other job where the boss was just mean and feisty. I mean, she was just not happy ever. And I thought, well, then I'm going to be happy. I'm going to be nice to her because I don't want to be on her bad side. And, you know, I remember praying and going into that job and asking the Lord to give me favor with her. And honestly, I got favor every time. Every time I needed my schedule change, I got whatever I asked for. Every time I needed a pay increase, she gave me one and nobody else was getting them, but I did. Every time whatever I asked, God's favor went before me. And I don't think it's because I was great at all. I think it's because I wanted to serve God, and I did it for him, and then he backed me up and covered me in it. And you see, when we work according to God and run our race for him, he's going to bless you on the job, okay? Amen. Let's be bold in telling the good news of Jesus for our race. When we see lost and broken people in this world, let it break your heart. Because the compassion of God wants to go out and he wants to love people deeply. And he's going to do that through you and I. He's asking us to run our race so that we can be a beautiful fragrance for him when we go out into the world. 2 Corinthians 2:14 says, "Now thanks be to God who always leads us in triumph in Christ and through us diffuses a fragrance. His knowledge in every place. For we are to God the fragrance of Christ among those who are being saved and among those who are perishing. To the one, we are an aroma of death leading to death, and to the other, an aroma of life leading to life. Who is sufficient for these things?" Listen, you are sufficient for these things. You carry the gospel. You bring that beautiful aroma and that fragrance into your family, into your home. Listen, I heard it said once that work is great, but I go home to a war zone. You have the ability to change that. You have the ability to change that because you are his hands. You are his feet. Get into the word. Ask the Holy Spirit how to change the atmosphere of your home. Ask the Holy Spirit what programs need to be changed in your watching capability, because what we watch, we let into our home. Be careful what you allow in. You see, running your race taps into some personal things. What is your eye gate seeing? What is our ear gate seeing? What are we speaking? Are we speaking death or life over our family and our children? Maybe the words of our mouth need to change. Maybe we need to speak faith, even though we don't see it. My kids are highly favored and they're blessed by God, and they're going to serve him all the days of their life. My spouse is going to come to know the name of Jesus, and he's going to preach it from the mountaintops. Or she's going to come back and serve the Lord with all of her heart, and she will not be led astray. You see, you have to get into some faith here. It's not just God doing it all. He's saying, I've given you the tools. You need to get to work, men and women. You need to run your race. You need to stand strong like David and Goliath, and you need to speak faith into our families. Let's run our race for Jesus. Let's be his ambassadors. Let's be his ambassadors. Everything we do is for God. And there was, I have just a clip for you guys. There's a video clip. Now, in the Olympics in 2016, these young men won the silver. I stand corrected. Yesterday I said the gold. And we went back and checked it. They won the silver. But this is before they got to the Olympics. And when they won the Olympics this year, NBC, God censored everything. So if they, right when they got interviewed, they would show it, but they wouldn't put it on YouTube. They wouldn't put it out there for the world to see because they honored God in everything they did. And so that should make us mad as Christians. Like, come on, censoring God. But you know what? What they did was so beautiful. We found another clip of right before they won, and it shows you what they did. And this is how we need to honor God with our lives, in our jobs, with our families. This will be a beautiful example. Please direct your eyes to the screen.
Accomplished everything they set out to do tonight, not just making the Olympic team, but putting together a complete set. And now, Steele Johnson, you are going to the Olympics. We see the emotion. Describe what's going through your mind.
I've been working for this dream for a long time, and it's honestly, I never thought like the day would come, and I feel like I just blinked. Now I'm on the 2016 Olympic team, but it's cool because this is exciting, this is fun, but like this is not where my identity is going to be in the rest of my life. Yeah, I'm Steele Johnson, the Olympian, but at the same time, I'm here to love and serve Christ. My identity is rooted in Christ and not in the flips we're doing.
So cool, huh?
It's all here, and it's... I wasn't ready for it.
Well, and for your partner, David Bodaya, Beijing, London, and now Rio, what has this journey meant to you?
Right before I was going up for this last side, emotions kind of poured in, and it wasn't like the first two teams that I made. I think because this guy has just come a long way, we can't take credit for this. God be the glory, and this is why we do what we do day in and day out, and this is a special moment. Steele made his first Olympic team. I made my third Olympics, but... We're just so thankful, and there's so many sacrifices that have been made by our coaches and my wife and family and my parents, just so many, but nothing compares to the sacrifice that we've had in eternity. So we're just thankful for this moment, and we're going to enjoy it.
So cool. That's what I'm talking about. They're diving their race really good. And you know what? Let's run our race beautifully, Rock Church. Can we do that? Can we be full-time ministers of the gospel of Jesus Christ? Awesome. Well, listen, nobody get up, nobody move, nobody stand up. This is the most important part of the service. I just have a couple more things and then we'll dismiss you. I want to talk to some of you today because some of you are in a trap and you don't even know you're in a trap. You say, what? Yep, you're deceived, and you don't even know you're deceived. You see, you think you're a Christian. You think you're on your way to heaven. You think that you'll make it there. But you're deceived in thinking that because the world has so trained us and taught us that all roads lead to heaven. And I'll tell you something, that is not true. We have to go by what the Word of God says. Remember the God perspective that we talked about today. Jesus says that I am the way, I am the truth, and I am the life, that no man goes before the Father except by me. And Jesus died on that cross for your sins today. He died on that cross like we talked about in the beginning of the message. He gave everything for your sins so you don't have to worry about it, so you don't have to suffer through it, so you can be redeemed and washed and cleansed and made a new creation in him. And maybe you don't understand today, but God says, he's a gentleman, and he will not just push his way into our lives. We have to ask him to come into our lives. That's called being born again. And there's a man by the name of Nicodemus in the Bible, and he didn't quite understand. He understood the word. He understood things of God, but he said, I don't understand Jesus. He said, I can't get back into my mother's womb. And Jesus says, no, Nicodemus, let me explain this. You're not getting it. What is born of flesh is flesh. But what is born of the Spirit is spirit. And so when we ask Jesus to come into our heart and be the Lord and Savior of our life, he will come in and we will become a new creation in him. It's actually a beautiful miracle that happens. And when we ask Jesus to come into our lives, we are doing what God has asked us to do. In his word, he says, you believe in your heart and confess with your mouth that he is Lord, then you will be saved. And God wants your heart today. You see, he formed you and he molded you, but we were born into the sin nature of a world. And sin separates us from God. And God is saying, I'm calling you home, just like that song said earlier, to come back to the throne, come back, because he loves you so intimately and so much that he wants a personal relationship with you. And maybe you don't know if you've ever asked Jesus to come into your heart and the Lord of your life. Maybe there's things inside of you that you've thought, I'm a Christian because I've been to church, or you know, I made it a tradition in my life. God is not a tradition. He's not a ceremony. It's not how we do things. He wants our personal relationship with us. It's not about having God in our heads. It's about having him in our heart. He wants to be a part of us. And so I want to ask you a few things. And you examine your heart. You just check yourself out. So what I'm going to do, I'm going to have everybody bow their heads. And I want, while I'm asking these questions, for you to just tap into you and God right now. This is personal. No one's looking around. You don't have to worry about the friend that brought you. You don't have to worry about the distraction of anything. You and God. If he were to come back today, would you make it to heaven or would you make it to hell? Say, I don't know. I hope so. Listen, you cannot hope your way into heaven. You have to make sure today. If you were somebody that maybe went to a camp or a Harvest Crusade or some type of function and you asked God to come into your heart and be the Lord and Savior of your life, but you never really followed it up, that's called being lukewarm. And Jesus says, you're either hot or you're cold, but if you're lukewarm, I will vomit you from my mouth. Those are harsh words from God, but he's so serious about eternity and he wants you with him that he's gonna let you know how it is, because there's heaven and there is hell. Whether we want to believe that hell is real or not, it is. The Bible talks about it all throughout hell. In fact, the demons even know Jesus is real and they believe in him. So it's not about just believing God. It's about asking him to come into your heart and be the Lord and Savior of your life. Maybe you have been running from God instead of to God, and it's time for you to stop running. Today's your day to accept him, to grab a hold of him, to take advantage of the love that he has. That's what he so wants for you today. And if you have never asked him to come into your heart and be the Lord and Savior of your life, I'm talking to you today. Today, make sure. Let's get him in your heart. Let's introduce you to him. This is how this will work. I'm going to ask you to raise your hand, and I'm going to ask you to be bold about it. You could look up now. I want you to see me. Jesus died on the cross for your sins. He died for all of our sins. And he did it so boldly. I'm going to ask you today, when I count to three, if you need to know Jesus, and I'll tap my hand on the Bible like that. And when I do, I want you to raise your hand. And if you, oh no, I don't want to do that. I'm embarrassed. Listen, you are in the most safest place you could ever be. Jesus loves you so much, and everyone in this room is praying for you that's a Christian, because we want you to be a part of our family. We want you in the kingdom of God. This is the purpose and the plan for your heart and your destiny. So please do not be embarrassed to raise your hand. If you were on your way to hell and you were in hell, you'd be raising your underwear on a flagpole like, get me out of here. I need to be saved, and it'd be too late then. So today, you're not promised tomorrow. So make sure today. So if you've been running from God instead of to God, I'm going to go like that. I'm going to ask you to raise your hand. The Word of God says that if you confess me before man, then I will confess you before my Father. But if you deny me before man, I will deny you before my Father. That's Jesus talking. That's some serious stuff right there. And he says, but if you raise your hand, I'll see your hand. And then you could put it down real quickly. And when you do, what we'll do is we'll ask you to come forward. We'll pray a prayer to ask Jesus to come into your heart and be the Lord and Savior of your life, okay? So what I'm going to do is, remember, if it is you that has been in this room and you've kind of hoped, wondered, maybe not quite sure, then today we're going to make sure. We're going to ask Jesus to come into our hearts with you. And if maybe you have never asked God to come into your heart and you've heard about this amazing Jesus and you want to be on the right race in life, then I'm talking to you today. And maybe you've been lukewarm, running from God, doing more of your own thing instead of God's thing. I'm talking to you today. So on the count of three, get ready. Get ready to raise your hand. I'm going to go one, two, three, and you're going to raise your hand on the count of three. One, two, three. Raise your hand. Raise your hand. If you need Jesus today. If you need Jesus today. Ushers, help me. One, I see your hand. You can put it down. Anyone else? Anyone else? Two, awesome. Three, awesome. Anyone else in the family room? Anyone else? Three people on a Sunday morning? Come on. Four. If you're sitting in here and going, I wish that big mouth lady preacher would be quiet. Listen, I love you, and I've been praying for you to come home. So I'm going to take some time. So that's four. There's seven more. Five. Anyone else? God wants your heart today. He loves you so much. He gave everything for you. Today's your day to come home. Anyone else? I'm going to close this down pretty soon. Just make sure. All right. Well, this is what we're going to do. Five incredible, wonderful, brave men and women of God are ready to give their hearts to God. So this is what I'm going to ask. I'm going to ask you to grab your sweater, your coat, your purse, your Bible, and a friend if you need a friend. And everybody's going to stand up, and I'd love to meet you. So could you come forward, and we're going to pray a prayer with you. Because you don't get saved just by raising your hand. You get saved by praying a prayer.
Father's arms are open wide.
Please do not leave right now. Do not leave. You're distracting.
God has an awesome plan for you.
God has amazing things ahead.
The altar, the Father's arms are open wide.
Hello.
Forgiveness was bought with.
Maybe you didn't raise your hand, but you need to. Come on up. Come on up.
Jesus Christ, oh, come to the altar. The Father's arms are open wide. Forgiveness was born with.
High five. Right on, buddy. All right. Well, this is how this works. Everyone here is totally excited for you because you get to be a part of an awesome, godly, amazing new future. But, yeah, they're excited. Sorry. But what we're going to do is we don't get saved by just coming forward or raising a hand. We have to ask Jesus to come into our heart and be the Lord and Savior of our life. So when we do that, we're going to pray a prayer. And when we pray a prayer, if you miss a word or whatever, it's not about the prayer, okay? It's about our heart and the attitude of our heart. Jesus is after our heart. That's the difference, is he wants to be in a relationship with us. And so when we pray this prayer, I'm going to pray a prayer. You guys can repeat after me. Everybody's going to repeat after you, so you won't be alone in it. And we're going to ask Jesus to come in and be the Lord and Savior of our lives, okay? Everybody bow your heads and repeat after me. Dear Father God, I ask you to come into my heart today. And be the Lord and Savior of my life. I confess you as Lord. And I confess you as Savior. Lord, I ask that you'd forgive me of my sins. And today, I am a new creation in Christ. I have a new future. Lord, I have a new hope in you. Help guide me. Help show me how to run this race. With you. Thank you, Jesus, for salvation, for a new life. Thank you, Jesus, for your forgiveness. In Jesus' name, amen. Awesome. Well, it's not over yet because this is Pastor Joel. And here at the Rock Church, we like to give away friends because we just like people, okay? So when you get saved, sometimes you're kind of like, what's next? What do I do next? This is kind of a new thing for me. Well, we'll meet with you about, what is it, 10 minutes? 20, 30 minutes? How long? 30 minutes? 15 minutes? I'm like changing it on him. We're going to meet on you. So 15 minutes before service, they'll buy you a drink or something, and they'll just go over what the Word of God says and kind of how to do life as a Christian, and it'll give you a friend. It'll bring you an accountability partner. It'll be such a beautiful thing, okay? So Pastor Joel is going to fill you in on that. If you go back with him right now, they'll sign you up. They'll just get your information. We love you. God bless you. It's going to be so exciting.